within the capitalist frame, the rules of the game are not as fixed as it appears. It's not true. You can be competitive and all that bullshit and still have healthcare and all the things and so on. So again, never forget that it's ideology. Second point. Even when we talk about this kind of universal public use of reason, this does not mean you should nonetheless be careful here. This does not mean neutral knowledge. Private use of reason versus public use of reason is not interested knowledge to solve problems versus some kind of neutral knowledge and so on. No, here both me and Alain, and this is crucial for Alain's notion, the way he puts it is that universality does not mean universality. Authentic universality is always grounded in a subjective engagement. You know, our notion of universality is not you think this, you have those interests, then a wise guy comes who sees, who doesn't have any engagements. So that's the first point to be made. And here, I wonder if you would agree, I hope I'm justified in presupposing that at least most of you here have already heard of how Alain developed his notion of fidelity to the event, truth event, and in his logics of the worlds. I'm talking about this not to flatter him, but I think this is one of his beautiful achievements. If you follow his work, you may have noticed, if you really followed it, not just in this confused way, as some people read Lacan, you know, where they take an early Lacan, they combine it with late Lacan in total confusion, that there is, and I think very correct change, very important positive, you can correct me if I'm wrong, change, shift, slight shift of position. In his letter of Levenbaum, being an event, you still have this circular definition of the event. Event includes its own nomination. What this jargonistic bullshit means is that an event is an event only for those engaged in it. No? For example, if you are somebody like François Furet, for you, French Revolution as an event doesn't exist. It's just empirical thing, and you know, the whole so-called bourgeois historiography, for example, tries to prove that even more than French Revolution, October Revolution was not an event. It was just some total catastrophic and totally marginal contingency in Russia and so on and so on. Now, if I read you correctly, I hope you do, you change here the position, and again, if I read you correctly, the way I read you is that, of course, event is not universal in the sense of for all times, blah, blah. You still keep this point with this crucial that event is always the event, the truth is always truth of a particular historical situation. But if I got you correctly, it, how should I put it, it affects the entire situation. You can no longer say, for example, after French Revolution, that it was an event only for those who were engaged in it. Even those who ignored it already reacted to it. It determines the entire field. So now, so that there will be at least some debate, I'm asking you, but you don't have to answer. You, in your book, propose a beautiful theory of four responses to the event. The faithful subject, the subject who in fidelity engages himself, the reactive subject, the subject who opposes by ignoring it, whatever, the obscure subject, like if I got you correctly, the reactive subject would have been bourgeois liberal rejection of revolution, obscure subject would have been a kind of a fascist, nihilistic, anti-communist reaction, and then resurrection of the event, like new event. I claim, it's very modest what I'm saying, that I'm tempted not to say this will be postmodern bullshit, that we have the multitude. No, it's not endless multitude. I would like just to add two more. And I think it works. And I will give you examples for three fields. First, let's call it Freud event, in the sense of discovery of psychoanalysis. We have fidelity, Lacan or those faithful to Freud. We have something that I call reactive normalization, which is you admit it, but you reintegrate it into the previous predominant field, ego psychology, or as they say, dynamic psychotherapy. They said Freud, great thinker, blah, 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 but you know, they retranslate it. Then you have outright denial, cognitivism, like bullshit, it's not, the idea is Freud is still this kind of a mantic dream reading stuff, nothing to do with science. Then you have obscurantist mystification in a pseudo event. This is what Jung does with Freud. Then you have total brutal enforcing of the event, Reich, Freudo-Marxism, this kind of a passion of the real, brutal. And then you have resurrection. I admit, like the, maybe more than original fidelity to Freud, this would have been, let's say, Lacan's return to Freud. I think this works because, very briefly, I will give you the same logic, I will try to exemplify it in two other fields. Let's take love, love as condom event. And I like the term condom, you know why? When I first entered the United States, I asked, what is this big building? They told me a condominium. And I thought, oh, you get free condoms there, it would be nice to live there. No? Okay, let me go on. First, it's fidelity. You are engaged in love. Then it's normalization, reintegration, marriage. Then it's outright rejection of the eventual status of love. Sexual adventure, liberty. You say love is nothing, it's just an illusion. Then you have direct rejection of sexual love, abstinence. Then you have obscurantist, this passion of the real, Tristan, whatever. You know. And then you have resurrected love. And this is, for example, if nothing else, I'm thinking here of, you know, Stanley Cavell's theory of comedies of remarriage, that for true love link, you must split, and then only the second time release. Then let's take the Marxism event. We have fidelity. You remain faithful, communist idea. Then you have reactive reintegration. It's clear, it's social democracy. No? Yeah, great workers' rights. You have outright denial of the eventual status, liberalism, and so on. You have catastrophic, this obscurantist counterattack, fascism. You have total enforcing of the event, which ends up in what you call, following Mallarmé, I think, obscure disaster, Stalinism, Khmer Rouge, whatever, and you have, of course, returns to the event. So I think that it is crucial to read the notion of the event in this way. But nonetheless, you can say, okay, it's nice what you say, but you are bullshitting a little bit in the sense of, okay, event, but what event there is today. Here I totally agree with Alain. Both of us have a certain respect for 20th century, but even today it's important to emphasize this. It's over. No nostalgia. It's really over. But what is over? Here, I would like to refer to a weird French guy called Georges Peyrol, who, back in the 80s, wrote a wonderful satire under the title, in 83, 30 Ways to Easily Recognize an Old Marxist. It's a wonderful, ironico-critical portrait of a traditional Marxist, certain that sooner or later one just has to be patient and wait, an authentic revolutionary workers' movement will explode, victoriously sweeping away the capitalist rule as well as the corrupted official Stalinist parties or trade unions and so on and so on. Okay, you probably know the answer to this joke. Georges, voilà, Monsieur Georges Peyrol, no?